Hey, this is Travis, and welcome back to a brand new episode of Home Course. Today we come from beautiful Virginia Beach, home of 3.5 military bases, home of the longest stretch of pleasurely beaches on the entire planet. It's also home to 6-time PGA Tour champion, Marc Leishman. Marc broke onto the scene on the PGA Tour in 2009, winning Rookie of the Year honors, and was the first Australian to take home that prize. Marc is the ultimate family guy. He's an aspiring greenskeeper. He owns his own beer company, and he's an overall great dude. Let's go head out to his place and check it out. Thank you for watching Home Course. Hopefully you've enjoyed this series so far. We've got a great episode ahead of us today. I'm excited for you to all watch. Home Course is brought to you by Ultimate Golf. Ultimate Golf happens to be my favorite game in my phone. It's a free download on Google Play or in the Apple App Store, and you can do that by following the link in the description of this video. Believe me, you're gonna wanna download it now and get in on the action. Ultimate Golf is a great game to play with your friends, your family, and oftentimes, they'll bring on notable celebrities that you can challenge as well. I'll be playing the Ultimate Golf app as I'm traveling in between shoots for Home Course, or just when I'm trying to escape from the everyday rat race or being on social media. Thank you to Ultimate Golf for being the presenting sponsor of this new series, Home Course. Hopefully you're all enjoying it and look forward to new episodes here in the future.
Hey, what's up, man? How's it going?
How you doing, mate?
Good to see you, dude. Yeah.
Welcome.
Yeah, let's check this place out, man. All right, well, hey, thanks for having us, man. Beautiful home. So why Virginia Beach?
Audrey's from here. We've been married 11 years, been in this house 6 years. We built it from scratch. I kind of designed the outside. Audrey did everything inside. So this kitchen is all her, nothing nice to do with me, and nice and bright. It's a good place to live.
Let's go take a look at the house and show us around some places and get to show everybody a little bit about Marc Leishman.
So, sounds good. Well, right. Let's cruise upstairs. So this was the first putting green we got put in the house when we moved in.
Nice.
Just sort of had this done, and it's got brake in it and everything, so it's kind of realistic. Runs at about 10 or 11, so
pretty quick.
Quick enough, yeah. Quick enough that I'm not going to leave a heap of putts short out.
Yeah.
You know, when I get on tour, so good to come up here and just, you know, the kids love it. Probably more for them than it is for me, to be honest.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the weather seems to be pretty good year round here, so you get to utilize obviously your backyard a lot. Did you get to design a lot of the break in this to stuff that you wanted to be working on or practicing?
Yeah, I did. So you can see sort of the baseboards over there. This bit's higher over here, so it's got right to lefters, left to righters, uphill, downhill.
I mean, yeah,
it's all pretty simple, but it definitely helps with my putting. I'm not really sentimental with a lot of stuff, but one thing that I do keep is all my head covers just the putter covers,
yeah,
from all the tournaments that they give us one. Most of the majors, they'll make a putter cover and a golf bag.
Yeah.
Normally I'll auction off the golf bag for our foundation, give the driver covers away and all that, and then keep the putter covers for myself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You gotta keep something for
exactly
yourself, right?
This one, my first win with Callaway was the Arnold Palmer Invitational down at Bay Hill. So they made me this putter cover with my name on it, AP, the date that I won, and I used it for a few years. You can see it's pretty worn and just a really good memory. Odyssey definitely do some really cool things with putter covers. I mean, this one was the playoff cover this year, the playoff beard. Unfortunately, I didn't advance all the way to the Tour Championship this year, but it's a pretty cool cover nonetheless. So occasionally I'll get a putt. I remember I had a putt a couple of years ago in LA, and I read it, and it was this exact putt.
No, are you
and it
serious?
Was just like, yeah, it was like, Maddie's like, geez, you hit that putt quick. I'm like, yeah, well, it was. There it is. Snuck it in the right edge.
Let's go up stairs and check out some more of the trophy room, some of those bags that you collected.
Cool.
All right, wow, okay. So there's a lot of history in this room here, so this is the trophy room, huh?
Yeah, it's a pretty cool room actually. All my old clubs, golf bags. You know, we were talking about the major bags.
Yeah, some of these look familiar.
Yeah, major bags, President's Cup, my Olympics golf bag. And then the ones that you see clubs in are ones that I've actually won with.
Marc Leishman, the Olympic athlete. That's pretty cool. Good experience to go play.
Yeah, that was really cool. You know, not something I really ever thought I'd ever do.
Yeah.
Being a golfer and not being good at any other Olympic sports. So to be an Olympian is really, really cool and something I can sort of keep with me forever. So one of the really cool things in this room is what we're actually standing on. It's a Moroccan rug. I played a pro-am at the Travelers with the Prince of Morocco and we won it. And then about 6 months later, we get this huge big package that looked like something that was dangerous.
Yeah.
And
just shows up randomly at the house.
Showed up randomly at the house and this 100-pound rug. So really cool thing, topic of conversation. Thought this was a perfect place for it. And yeah, really nice of him to send that to me.
Walk us through some of this stuff that you have up here on the trophy case.
Yeah, so first win was the Travelers up there on the top right. That was 2012 with the pitcher. When Tim Fincham was commissioner, he'd send us a pitcher like that with you're holding the trophy, which was awesome. Bay Hill, which was 5 years later, is up here. That was a really special win just because it was the first win that I'd had with my family there, my kids. They ran out onto the green. A pretty awesome experience. I won the BMW. A few months later, that fits seven cans of beer in it.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah, we emptied that a few times at the celebration party, and then one of my most satisfying wins was Torrey Pines there, the Torrey Pine Trophy. I'd come close there a lot of times, but never was able to get over the line, and to do it that year in 2020 was pretty special. The second in the British Open, that's the plate there.
Mm-hmm.
To come so close in a major and not get over the line was very disappointing. And every time I look at that, I do think about what might have been.
Yeah.
But makes me, you know, work hard and try and get the first place in a major trophy up here.
Got a couple other close calls. I see this picture up here with you and Scotty. Little funny story there. On that green, you want to walk us through a little bit?
Yeah, so
Masters.
I was on the edge of the green. It had been raining for, you know, the last few holes. So, you know, obviously we were a little wet and cold. Scotty made that putt to what we thought was to win the Masters. Went over and gave him a massive high five and just ripped my hand, made the biggest noise. Hand was bright red, ringing, like almost like to the point of being numb. And then I had about 4 foot to finish,
still
the par to finish. I think it was fourth.
Okay.
A
lot of money on the line.
Worth probably $200,000-$300,000. I'm not exactly sure what, yeah. But I had this putt and I'm like, I just hope I just hit a decent putt because it was really important. Anyway, I ended up making it. So not as good a story as it could have been, but yeah, that was a pretty special moment. And for Scotty to go on and win that tournament was
makes
that
Masters
photo even more special.
All right, got a little man cave action over here too. A little extension of the trophy room.
Yeah, so this is my sports room, I guess we'll call it. I've got the three TVs up on the wall here. Good to be able to just come up here on a Sunday, watch three games of football or, you know, hockey at night time or whatever it is and just get away. I love watching multiple games of American football at once. I find it a little slow because I didn't grow up with it.
Yeah.
But hockey's my American sport. Love the hockey, the Capitals. I'm a Caps fan.
Okay.
So we get up to as many games as we can. Of that, I feel like it's just fast flowing and really enjoy the hockey.
You can see you got this bad boy laying around here. What exactly is this for?
That's just a pellet gun.
Okay.
A BB gun.
All right, you gotta show us the way here.
Gotta see if we can get this target. Got the tree at least.
There you go.
Let it rip. Yeah, it lets off a little bit of steam. Doesn't hurt anything. Good fun.
Not hitting other than just normal, just traditional targets.
Exactly, no.
All right, so we've seen a lot of stuff shot and stories told of you know, your ability to take care of your own landscaping and your obsession with, you know, your backyard green and stuff. So here we got a little upstairs view of this backyard. So excited to get down there and check it out and just have you walk us through a little bit about what you do to take care of this thing and your love for grass.
So and we've got a new artificial green to show you as well.
Oh,
so we got
perfect. Yeah. All right, let's go ahead down. All right. Let's check it out. So here's the infamous backyard practice area.
Yeah, we just had the artificial green put in. It actually reacts really good, like yeah. a proper green.
So this is new this year?
Yeah, this has been in for probably 2 months.
Okay.
And then overseeded this year. Turned out all right so far. We got a bunker up there as well. And yeah, it just gives me something to do during the winter because the Bermuda goes completely dormant.
Yeah.
And it doesn't soak up any water, so it just gets real wet and
yeah.
no good. But at least with this, it's going to soak up a bit of the water.
Yeah.
Keep it green. And, yeah.
So obviously with your schedule, very demanding, traveling, playing golf. I mean, a lot of people don't realize this that are just like light viewers of golf, but traveling alone is just tough regardless of what you're doing. And then when you get there, you're playing practice rounds, playing pro-ams where you're hosting guests and fans.
Yep.
And then the grind of just day-to-day tournaments itself. And then if you've been to an event, you see like after a practice round, you don't just go back to your hotel. Like you go to the putting green, you go to the chipping area, you go to the,
yep.
the driving range. So when you're home and you're not playing in an event, like you have 3 weeks off right now, I mean, is this kind of where you see yourself doing most of your practice, or do you go to like a club? I mean, obviously you got to get full swings in, but
no, you don't have to.
Okay.
Oh yeah. No, actually, before Houston, I took 3 weeks off where I didn't play.
Didn't even touch a club, or
I was leading after the first round.
Yeah.
We won't talk about the last three rounds, but I'll mostly keep my feel out here.
Okay.
Just you know, can hit 70-yard shots. I feel like you can keep your feel in that. You know, having chipping comps with my sons. Yeah. I just when I get to a tournament, I like to feel fresh and want to play golf. If I practice too much on my weeks off, I get to a tournament and it's just kind of like going through the motions. I feel like I don't have too much to do because I've done the practice leading into it.
Yeah.
And I just kind of end up wasting time.
Yeah.
I like going there with a purpose. Obviously you have to, you know, stay somewhat sharp.
But,
sure. I feel like I can do that out here.
Walk us through like this area here. You see the stripes in the grass and it's just nicely manicured. We've seen some content of you taking care of this yard before in the past, but like what got you into wanting to do this like yourself and learning about it?
I'm not a gym guy.
Okay.
The exercise, I really like the exercise. It's a lot of steps to cut your grass by hand. And it's just instant gratification. You know, you cut it and it looks good straight away.
Yeah.
That's what I love about it. But it's just ongoing. You have to keep doing it. Time fertilizing for when, you know, when I'm here, and if I'm away, I've got to put growth regulators on it so I don't get back and it's like a forest.
Yeah.
I just enjoy the challenge of it. And I think that the biggest thing is that instant gratification. When you cut it, it looks good straight away. With two dogs, you get a few dead spots, as you can see. But
come dogs and kids, you get challenges.
Exactly.
But...
yeah, but no, it's just good, you know, do this, work up a bit of a sweat, and then you can earn a beer at the end of the day.
Absolutely. There we go. Tell me you got that. All right. Whatever we do the whole season, you guys have to put that on there. I know you offered me to hit some shots from back there. I just didn't want to hit your house. So spare that content for everybody to see. But this has been incredible to see your house and let us in. So we appreciate that.
Yeah, no worries. Thanks for coming.
So a few years ago, I guess in 16, you launched Leishman Lager. Obviously big in Australia, starting to make its way here locally in Virginia. I think you said down to Florida as well.
Yep.
Back Bay Brewery here locally is something that you have a interest in as well. And excited to dig into that. Why don't we head over to the brewery and check out some of that stuff and go have a beer.
Yeah, let's cruise over and taste the product.
Thank you to Ultimate Golf for being the presenting sponsor of this new series, Home Course. Hopefully you're all enjoying it. It's a free download on Google Play or in the Apple App Store, and you can do that by following the link in the description of this video.
All right, we're here with Travis with Back Bay Brewing. Check this all out. So this venture started a few years ago back, you alluded to at your house. Like, what made you want to get into, you know, beer and creating your own lager?
Well, originally it was going to be a 1 month long beer. Uh-huh. Going to make one batch, sell it for a month, and then the proceeds would go back to the Begin Again Foundation. But I thought, well, if I'm going to have my name on a beer, I want it to be good and taste how I want it to taste. So me and Travis tasted a heap of different beers. I told him what I liked about the beers and didn't like about the beers, and he wrote everything down, came up with a recipe, came up with Leishman Lager, and first go it was really good. So that was about 5 years ago. Yeah. Just canned another lot, and it's been a lot of fun.
I can imagine it'd be a lot of back and forth, like perfecting it. I mean, you had probably something in your mind that you wanted it to be. What was important for you, and was it really just one go, or did it take a few iterations? Or,
well, that's what I was so impressed with this fella right here. He did a great job. It was the first beer was amazing. I mean, I wanted it to taste like my favorite Australian beer. I wanted it to look that, have that golden color. I feel like a lot of American beers lose their head really quickly. Uh-huh. I wanted the head retention to be good, so you get the rings around the glass as you're drinking it. That's what a lot of Australian beers do, and it was, you know, we've tinkered it a little bit. Well, yeah. Travis has tinkered it with the recipe a little bit, but just fine tuning.
Hey, your suggestion.
He did a really good job. Yeah, yeah. He did a really good job.
So light, easy drinking, with a little bit of flavor in there. Like, have something that, something that's not just like your easy light beer, but something that you still drink a bunch of. Yeah. It's kind of what we talked about. You wanted something that had flavor, something that would stand out, but something that was also like really easy to drink. Something you could have five or six of them as you're golfing.
Yeah.
When we start a process, we will come up with the entire recipe. We'll do, we'll figure out what grains we want, what kind of hops we want, and all that can factor into the type of flavors that you get out of the beer. In that area is the grain storage right outside. And then the grain comes to us, we mill it, and we'll throw it into our brew house. So this is our brew house. We're working it with 15 barrels at a time. The barrel is 31 gallons. The grain comes into this kind of cone-shaped thing, falls into the this top part we call a mash tun, and we mix it with hot water. And we're trying to convert the naturally occurring starches into fermentable sugars in that part. After a certain period of time in there, we'll move it, we'll strain off all the solids, and we'll just have this sugary water, essentially, called wort. And that's in the kettle. We'll boil the wort for anywhere from an hour to 4 or 5 hours sometimes, if you want like a really heavy, really alcoholic beer. We'll do that. We'll add our hops in there. We'll add fruit in there. We'll add, you know, sometimes, you know, whatever you need to add. Move it over to this bottom part. It's called the whirlpool. Mm-hmm. It does exactly that. Just spins it around really, really fast. And all those hops that we might have put in, all those the proteins that might have come out of solution will just kind of come to the center in a cone. And then we pull off from the side, run it through a heat exchanger, and then throw it in one of the tanks. Let the yeast do their job. Well, we do have some Leishman in two, one of the fermenters. So we could try it like while it's still in process of fermenting. You get naturally occurring, so one of the byproducts of fermentation is carbon dioxide. And if we keep the tank sealed, all that carbon dioxide that's being released into the atmosphere will eventually go into solution. And that's what's happening here.
Yeah, he's not just really bad at pouring a beer.
I've had some bartenders pour worse than that.
Yeah, I know.
If Monday was a beer, that's what it would look like. When we designed this beer, a couple of things that Marc really wanted were really strong whitehead. So, yeah, as you can see.
Mission accomplished.
Yeah.
Right here, Marc.
Yeah.
That's
The clarity is not going to be quite there yet because it's still active in fermentation. You still have a lot of those particles that are still sitting inside of there. Toward the end of fermentation, a lot of the stuff will settle out. So on here, you'll get actually a little bit more yeast flavor than anything that you won't get in the can, but you'll get kind of the idea. Everything else should be pretty close.
This is early to be double fisting.
Yeah, it is. But here we are.
All right.
Let's try it. All right, so it's been a great day out here in Virginia Beach. Marc, thank you for having us out. Thanks to your wife, Audrey, to have opening up your home to us and showing us everything you guys got. It's amazing, great career so far on the PGA Tour. Gonna break down that door this year, hopefully win that first major. We're looking forward to that. And thanks for having us out here at the brewery. This is amazing. So just appreciate you.
Yeah, no worries. Thanks for coming. Yeah. Hope you guys enjoyed it. And yeah, like I say, hope we can get that major and be doing this all again next year.
Absolutely. If you haven't had a Leishman Lager, if you haven't been here to the farmhouse, the Back Bay Brewery, make sure to check it out when you're in Virginia Beach. So until next episode, thanks everybody.
Cheers. Thanks, mate.